anybody. And the third question is this, number three, when I pray, is prayer really effective or not? How many of you have ever really wanted to know that? Does it really make a difference? I don't know if you've ever heard the story or seen the movie or any of the many, I think there's some different shows about a young girl who was kidnapped by the name of Elizabeth Smart. How many know who I'm talking about? A young girl in California who was kidnapped almost 20 years ago now, I guess. But in March 3rd of 2002, she was found, incredibly, after 9 months of captivity. And one night, Jareen and I watched a movie about that kidnapping, and it told the whole story. And it was very interesting how she found and returned to her parents. But what I have gathered from the movie and the articles and things that I have read is that the Smart family were Christians, all right? They were people who believed in prayer. And Tom Smart, the dad, has been quoted as saying this: I don't know, or I don't think any little girl was prayed for more in the history of the world. It made headlines, international headlines, all over the world. And how many of you realize when something like that happens, people all over the world pray? How many of you pray when you watch the news, when you hear something on the radio, when you see an Amber Alert? Come on. People pray, all different levels of faith, all different levels of expectancy. And thank God for the Smart family, right? They got a happy ending, right? But what about the people who get kidnapped and there's not a happy ending? Have you ever thought about that? And sometimes it's a negative ending. People prayed and then something happens and people died. And what Satan likes to do, Satan likes to jump on things like that. And he likes to tell people, listen, your prayer doesn't make a difference. It doesn't matter. It doesn't make a difference. And we have to admit that sometimes it always doesn't end up the way we want it to. And we wonder why not. And how many of you realize that God's word does not give a slanted view of prayer? Last week we were in Acts chapter 12, right? And we, you know, if you've read Acts 12, you know that Peter was in prison and wow, it was a miraculous escape. An angel comes by and he just walks out of the prison scot-free. And what a glorious thing, and an answer to prayer. But the chapter begins with James. James also was taken, and undoubtedly the people who knew about James, they were praying about James, but guess what happened to James? He died. He got killed, right? And so Satan jumps on that and makes us wonder, what is this? Is prayer real? Does it really work? Does it really make a difference when we pray? Several years ago, John Wimber was speaking at a conference, and John is the founding pastor of really a group of churches called Vineyard Church, and they have been noted for their healing services where people come and with all kinds of sicknesses and illnesses and diseases, and they come to the front and they pray, and many are miraculously healed. And it's my understanding that they asked John Wimber towards the end of his life to teach on this particular topic, and the topic was, do you still believe in healing even though everybody you pray for isn't instantaneously and miraculously healed? Do you still believe in praying for the sick? And this was John Wimber's answer. This is what he said. I think it's a great answer. He said, through the years, I and others, I'm one of those others too, by the way. How many of you pray for people who are sick? Come on, wave at me if you prayed. I and others have prayed for thousands of people to be miraculously healed, and some were. But what I know is in every case, prayer helped. God used prayer to comfort, to encourage, to strengthen faith, to lift spirits. In every single case, prayer helped. And did you know that researchers are actually doing studies on prayer and the power that prayer has? And you know, a lot of these are about people who pray and they study that, and that people know that they're praying. But there, some scientists are actually taking this a little bit further. Some scientists are looking at the impact that the prayers of others have on the recovery of a patient when the patient doesn't even know they're being prayed for. And the most famous study was done by a Dr. Randolph Bird at the University of California. And this is what he did. How many of you are still with me today? Wave at me, all right? He took nearly 400 cardiac patients that had come in with heart attacks, and he put half in a study group, and And he didn't, but he didn't tell anybody. He took 200 names and he gave them to people all across the country. And he said, pray for these people. And these people were praying for the people, but they didn't know the patients. The patients didn't know they were being prayed for. The doctors or the nurses didn't know they were being prayed for. Nobody knew anything that these 200 were being prayed for except the researchers themselves. And here, and so half the heart patients were being prayed for, the other half were not, and they all got the same great state-of-the-art high-level cardiac medical treatment at the same facility, but half were being prayed for and half were not. And the results were astounding. How many of you want to hear the results? Come on. Here's the results. Those who were prayed for were less likely to develop congestive heart failure. They were 5 times less likely to require antibiotics, 3 times less likely to need diuretics. None of those who were prayed for required a breathing tube. Fewer of the prayed for developed pneumonia. Fewer needed CPR after the procedure. And none of those who were being prayed for died. Another medical researcher was looking at this very meticulous study, and this was what he had to say. He said, if the therapy being evaluated had been a new drug, it would have undoubtedly been heralded as a medical breakthrough. Come on. Can we give the Lord a big hand of praise? Come on. I don't know about you, but I believe in prayer. Well, you say, well, Pastor Bob, should we just focus on prayer and leave the doctors alone? Absolutely not. Luke was a physician. God gave us doctors. I'm grateful for doctors, aren't you? God gave wisdom to men. Amen? And God wants to use that wisdom to help us get better. I believe in doctors. But let me tell you something. Here's what I believe. I believe that God always wants to be invited in. God always wants to be a part of it. God always wants to for us to look to Him and to trust Him. And the reason for that is because He cares for us. Tell your neighbor, the Lord cares for you. Come on. 1 Peter 5:7 says this, cast all your anxiety upon Him because He cares for you. Amen. And so when we're praying for other people, we have this incredible privilege kind of to stand in the middle. And on the one hand, we hold the hand of those who are hurting, maybe sick, maybe addicted, maybe broken, maybe in need of salvation, and we're praying for them. And on the other hand, we're holding the hand of God, whose love and compassion and power and grace is incredibly real. And we get to be the conduit which the Lord flows through. One lady who writes about prayer said this, when we pray, we're not praying to God to gain His favor. We're not praying for God so His purposes get advanced, but we're actually praying with Him as His partners in His work. Come on. That's what happens. Amen. We're fulfilling the Lord's command in Romans chapter 12 that tells us, rejoice with those that rejoice and weep with those that weep. Amen. And so here's the point of personal application today. Amen. Not only can you relax, but you can be reassured. Amen. You can be reassured. Listen, be reassured. Prayer works. Prayer works. Prayer makes a difference. Amen. Here's the fourth point, the final point. How many are still with me? When I pray, can I mess it up or not? Powerful question. And here's the thing. How many of you realize you don't have to be perfect to pray or nobody would pray? Tell your neighbor, ain't nobody perfect. Tell your neighbor that. Isn't anybody perfect? You don't have to use perfect words. You don't have to know perfectly the Bible. God's going to help us all out on that. But there are areas of praying that can affect whether or not our prayers bless or help other people. And someone called these areas prayer busters. They're things that if we're messing up, they can hinder our prayers and the effectiveness will be gone. I'm going to give you several, and you can jot them down, and we're going to mainly talk about the first two or three here today. But the first prayer buster is this, and I just simply call it prayerlessness. Prayerlessness. How many of you realize we can talk about prayer all day long? We can have a Bible study about prayer. We can do all this stuff about prayer. But if we don't pray, guess what? We're not going to get any answers. Come on. How many of you have ever had good intentions about praying for someone, but you didn't? Come on. Let's be honest today. James chapter 4 and verse number 2 tells us this. You do not have because you do not ask God. You don't have because you don't ask God. And we could actually say, we could take out the pronoun you, put I in there. We could say, I do not have because I do not ask God. Wouldn't it be incredible if you get to heaven and you say to the Lord, I just don't get it, Lord. Why? All this stuff that was going on with me. And he would just say, well, why didn't you just ask? As easy as that sounds, we need to constantly be asking the Lord, right? And when, how many of you realize when our friends are in trouble, we might turn to a Christian counselor to get advice? That's good, right? We might go to a Christian bookstore and get the latest book on the topic and give it to a friend. That's good. We might even write down on a prayer list our intent to pray for that person. But until we have actually prayed, we haven't just failed to do a good thing. Until we prayed, we have failed to very best thing. Come on, somebody. The Bible said the reason why your prayers aren't being answered is that you haven't prayed them yet. You haven't asked. You've got to have focused prayer. That's what's missing from our word, from our world. We don't pray. Researchers tell us that 25% of the people who pray say it's their last resort. They pray as a last resort. In other words, one out of four say, well, I'm going to try everything else first, and if all that fails, I guess I'll have to pray. It's like the pastor who told the deacon, we need to call a prayer meeting. We've got some issues going on. We've got to pray. And the deacon says, has it come to that? Really? Come on. That's the first thing we ought to do is pray. Come on. And so I want to help you get started down the road of praying more. How many say I'd like to pray more? Come on. Okay, let me give you a few little tips. First of all, number one, when someone asks for prayer or you find a need, don't just pray immediately. Just pray right then, right there on the spot. Whenever you know, there's a little saying I have, the older I get, the more I forget, all right? The older I get, the more I forget. Pastor Bob, will you pray for me? Yes, I will, and then I forget, right? So here's the thing. When someone asks you to pray, just do it right there. It doesn't matter if you're in the Taco Bell line. You know, just say, man, I'll pray right now. Come on. People might be freaked out a little bit by that, but that's okay. Pray wherever, whenever, and then email your prayers. People send you an email prayer request. Amen. Don't just, you know, put that in the I'm going to do this later column. Immediately just type a reply and say your prayer. Just like you were praying, just type it all out and send it to them, right? And how about insomnia praying? Who's ever woken up in the middle of the night? You know, it's 4:32 a.m. and there you are looking at the clock. I'm going to tell you something. The devil will sing you a lullaby to put you back to sleep every night if you begin to call on God and you begin to pray and you begin to seek the Lord. Let me tell you something, he doesn't like that. He'll try to get you to go back to sleep. But let me tell you something, God may have woke you up for a reason. Ask God, who do I pray for? Amen. And pray everywhere, all the time. Pray in the shower, pray when you're driving, pray when you're in the elevator. Come on. Amen. Wherever you are, just start praying. Come on. Ask the Lord. Ask. And there's a great scripture that says this, ask and you will receive that your joy might be full. Come on, how many of you say, I want my joy to be full today? Then all you got to do is ask.